Again, we have the privilege of continuing with our series. And today, we have one special guest, and the other one of our own. So what I will do is to briefly introduce them, and then I'll tell you about the format we will follow today. Since we have two guests, we are going to apportion the time accordingly, meaning our main speaker, Yao, is going to take about 15 minutes to give us an overview of his current work. And then our special guest, Bright Ackwerh, will then be engaged by Yao himself in a sort of a dialogue, meaningful dialogue, for about 20 minutes. And then after this, the floor will be open for your contributions, questions. So let me begin by introducing Yao. So Yao is no stranger among us. Yao, is there anybody here you don't know? Right? Do you think? So Yao is currently a graduate assistant in our own institute here. And of course, his research interests intersect African art production and philosophical thought. He recently completed his thesis, and the title of the thesis is Representations of Women in Contemporary Ghanaian Painting. Is that correct? Have you changed any mind since then?
I'm still waiting.
Any new discoveries since then?
Quite a lot.
Quite a lot. So hopefully we'll hear some of them. And then coming back to our special guest, Bright Ackwerh, as you may already know, is one of the emerging contemporary visual artists in Ghana today. He is a product of the art faculty at KNUST, where he received his DFA and MF in painting and sculpture. Of course, his main fields are painting, illustration, and street art. And we'll learn more about street art today, especially in relation to cartoon. And most importantly, he received in 2016 the Ghanaian Prize for Contemporary Ghanaian Art. That's very important for many reasons. Number one, I was there personally to witness and record the whole event, including the keynote speech. And it's part of me. We learn more about our own society, appreciate what's coming out and into that society. So for me, it's a special moment to have him next to me here right now. And thank you for coming. It's continuing, just a few comments about my friend right here. Well, some will describe him as, I will quote some descriptions of him. In quotes, his style is a satirical representation of Ghanaian sociopolitical and religious issues in an incisive manner that provokes conversations, sparks debate, and elicits response. He draws huge inspiration from who? Fola Kuti Anikulapo. He believes that the music culture has a certain power to influence and inspire people. And also, in addition to that, for me, again, I have a personal interest in this topic, engaging the notion of music, not just as a political tool and medium, an incisive tool for communicating social ideas. For example, I co-sponsored or co-supervised a thesis here, and the thesis by Inusa, I only titled A Critique of the Political Philosophy So for me, the intersection of music, art, including literary forms, are very important. And it's an everyday experience of what I do. So again, that's why I have a special interest in this subject of today. So in this case, I invite Yao and a special guest to take over. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So my presentation, or the presentation by Bright and I, is titled Silent Parts. And why silent parts? Towards the end of the presentation, we would know why we settled on such a theme. But basically what we'll be doing is to engage the use of humor in Bright Ackwerh's Abonsam cartoons. So my objectives for this presentation is quite simple. I intend to emphasize the potential effect of humor in political cartoons. At this point, let me make the disclaimer that my talk on humor would be centered or focused on that which is used in political cartoons. Of course, humor is a polyvalent technique, and it finds its way through so many different mediums and whatnot. But for me, my concern would be that in political cartoons. Also, my second objective for this presentation is to advance the concept of humor as used in political cartoons as medupe, which is a quiet and nourishing rain. So for this to happen, basically what I would want you to join with me through an introduction where I just give a short background, methodology, research questions. Also, I'll now veer into political cartoons and give a description, and also the character of political cartoons, or the Iwa, as I said in Yoruba. And also give a few notes on humor, and at this point I'll bring my conceptualization, which I'm also steadily developing. Then the second part of the presentation would focus on Bright Ackwerh, and here also I'll be introducing him and talking about his Abonsam cartoons. So he would be also taking us through what Abonsam cartoons is, and this would be in the form of a conversation, and would also open up to the audience for it to partake. So for this paper, for my methodology, it's a case study, and here I'm focused on Bright Ackwerh and also engaging his visual works. And a case study, as you all know, allows for a detailed contextual analysis. And why I settled for Bright Ackwerh also towards the end of the presentation, we'll come to know, but I think our chair has already enumerated some of these points. Also, I'll be doing a visual analysis, and then I'll be sampling an overall of works from Bright Abonsam cartoons from the year 2016 through to the present. And also, I'll be using a series of unstructured interviews, which I prefer to call conversations, also with Bright Ackwerh, to make some points. For my research questions, what I intend answering is, what is the effect of humor in Abonsam cartoons? Also, what visual cues are used in Ackwerh's Abonsam cartoons, and what responses are evoked? These are my research questions for now. I'm pretty sure that as the conversation goes deeper, more will evolve. So I would want to begin my presentation by engaging a contemporary in African art for a short period. And if you are to engage the works of Enwezo and Okeke Agolu, they do inform us that contemporary African art since the 1980s, that's where they study our contemporary from, has confronted white issues facing Africans post-independence. the development of contemporary African art to a degree, according to them also, was facilitated by the creation of galleries and museums from the 1980s and a proliferation of such spaces in the 90s and 2000s. The notion of contemporary, however, always seemed to evoke a modern conundrum, but this can be resolved if we listen to Enwezo and Okeke Agolu, who note the fact that the contemporary is not necessarily a shift from tradition, which many people associate tradition with, or contemporary art as a break from tradition, but which they call this a process of distilling. But rather, they see the contemporary forms of art as new traditions in art making, as Africa also confronts its complex modern history. So once again, I'm also focusing on, in the contemporary, there are so many societal challenges that contemporary African art intends confronting, but once again, I'm focusing on that aspect, which is political cartoons, and how Bright also uses his cartoons to address some of the contemporary challenges. And also, the contemporary art contains a deep store of intellectual inquiry that I feel like in this present day and age, you should be definitely tapping into, and also deconstructing some of the many thoughts that Ackwerh and his contemporaries are also putting to bear. So what then are political cartoons? So these are single graphic panels. By single graphic panels, I mean what we see here, whereby you just have a depiction of an image which tells a story. Also, according to Adejuwon and Alimi, who argue that cartoons are illustrations, and also that how cartoons function in the political process in Nigeria. They mentioned that cartoons do utilize humor and satire as language. Also, in another text, we hear that political cartoons do offer critical commentary. And a seminal book by Child Press, The Political Cartoon, which is really seminal in this field, he mentions that cartoons do influence governmental action. But then for me, it may be seen as too much of a task to place on cartoons the responsibility of influencing governmental actions. And here outside with Manning and Fidian, two authors who argue that instead cartoons do rather place on its viewers the responsibility of discernment, and if anything at all, it rather reinforces already held opinions. Also, cartoons provide a summary of a situation or event in ways that are really succinct, and they also, which are so easy to grasp. So here I would want to talk just shortly about Child Press again and his theory of cartoons. So he outlines three areas of cartoons. One, in totalitarian regimes, for him, cartoons must praise and denounce the enemies of leaders. And this we see especially with Nkrumah, in the pre-coup cartoons, whereby the cartoons produced were to basically sing praises of Nkrumah as a messiah. Also in authoritarian regimes, he says that cartoons are unsteady and they serve to delegitimize the leaders by comically exposing blunders. Also here we see critical examples, especially in Cameroon, whereby many cartoonists were chased out of the country as they tried to delegitimize the leaders. Also in liberal democracies, cartoonists now become watchdogs who keep who try to keep the state accountable, and they do this by letting the state know that we see you and your follies. So what has allowed the political cartoons and people like Bright to practice freely? We got to look in our constitution of 1992. So there is in section article 162 section 4, we are informed of the relative freedom of the press. And this is relative because if you have to go into article 164, which states that the provisions of article 162 and 163, which ensures the relative freedom of the press, are subject to laws that are reasonably required in the interest of national security, public order, public morality, and for the purpose of protecting the reputations, rights, and freedoms of other persons. So even though you are free to express your opinions, it must still not contradict, or it must still not conflict with that of national security, which can be, which is vaguely defined. Also in this decade, we've seen like the boom of social media, and this has also accounted for a major space where counter-narratives, as Bright puts out there, find its way to the consciousness of the people. So here I want to quote Wationgo, and here too I also see cartoons as a release, and in his book Wizard of the Crow, a really powerful satire, in page 3, he, as a narrator, he says, just as offensive gases of the constipated need to be expelled, thus easing the burden on the tummy, anger in a person also needs a way to ease the burden on the heart. And as a result, cartoons also become a way whereby that anger, that frustration, that we want to vent at our leaders, it helps ease the burden. So in a way, cartoons become like a coping mechanism, which if anybody knows Kendrick Lamar, sounds something like "We Gonna Be Alright," but that's one of the so then, what's the Iwa of political cartoons? I use Iwa Lewa. If anybody has engaged the works of Abiodun, Roland, an art historian in Yoruba, he informs us that Iwa means character, and that is the essence of any art object. And the beauty of the art object is its character. So I use that also, instead of talking about the functions and roles, I'm looking at the character of the cartoons. And here we see that it's a powerful visual language which can aid as a corrective measure by Sanieta, who also talk about the role of humor in the construction of satire in Nigerian political cartoons. Cartoons also do serve as historical documents. So as we can see, especially in this image here, this image will forever be preserved as a historical document. When the Chinese embassy threatened to stall diplomatic relations with Ghana, Bright really is what he called them, threatened really to speak to the fact that threats and whatnot were coming. And we see what looks like a kufuad over there, a banner that says, or a sign that says stop. Also, cartoons do make succinct visual points, and they're also a creative form of disseminating news information, and they also illuminate complex political issues as affecting people's lives, and they tend to be a permanent opposition as they tend to have a cynicism towards people in power through languages of satire and humor. So my notes on humor, and here too comes from combing through other literature. So humor has been said to be a powerful feature of political cartoons, and why is this? It drives the message at the same time masking it, and it also disarms as it does not allow much resistance. So in a sense, they tend to be deceptively nice. Cartoons also point as they tend to be deceptively nice as they point the hubris and hypocrisy of the political landscape. For Fianco et al. Too, cartoons do elicit the viewer's participation by spiking interest. And this in my own experience, when I'm in countries whereby I do not necessarily speak the language or understand what is going on, I tend to find myself just looking at newsstands and then looking at the political cartoons to understand what the political climate in their country looks like. Also, by Obadare, he mentions that cartoons aid in the subversion, deconstruction, and engagement with the state by the dominated class and society. Once again, it serves as a double mechanism, he says, which allows for collective critique as well as a coping mechanism. And in this image, which Bright titles "To Catch and I'll Confirm," basically, it speaks to the fact that the corruption, the game of catching, what do you call it, like people who are corrupt has become so slippery that Kufuor himself is, or Martin Amidu is like struggling to catch their confirm that Akufo-Addo promised that when he comes into power, he's going to make sure that those who spend state money will be brought to justice. And in the background, we see the ex-president, as well as his animal character, which has become his best buddy, the dead goat he invoked in a burst of laughter. So, also, the responses that cartoons get tend to become the markers of the parameters of freedom of expression. And Godfrey Mwapemba, who is a cartoonist in Kenya, who was sacked from his job at the Daily Nation, said that cartoons are a barometer of press freedom in any country. So if we had to look on the screen, we see how, for example, in Rwanda, just this October, they had a new penal code that has banned cartoons that humiliate public officials. And of course, in Rwanda, it has been said that the freedom of expression there is relatively low. In Ghana, though, we have Bright Ackwerh, who the Chinese mission was angry over some of his depictions, as well as some of the media reportage, and they called for the government to intervene. I think Bright would tell us how that went in the second part. Then there is Ayanda Magulu, who, to briefly describe him, I'll say is a Bright Ackwerh but on steroids in South Africa. He recently compared Madiba to Satan as well as to Hitler, and he reports that he's been targeted by people. So eventually, cartoons tend to be like a marker of like press freedom. For Bright here, well, we say that Ghana, due to our constitution and whatnot, it allows a relative freedom for Bright to operate, but for how long, we'll find out. So this is the most important part for me, developing a concept called Medupe. I encountered a concept of Medupe reading Aikoyama's Remembering the Dismembered Continent. And when I encountered it, I was like, oh, this would be a beautiful name for a child. But here I am now trying to use it as a concept for humor. Medupe is a Sesotho concept, and it's known as a quiet and nourishing kind of rain. But Aikoyama beautifully puts it in his work, and it deserves to be quoted at length here, that this is not any kind of rain, especially not a violent, spectacular rain that comes in sudden storms. Small rain, but useful rain, the kind of rain that falls in fine, tiny drops, just a drizzle, sometimes, but falling steadily for hours on end, sometimes for days without interruption. The kind of rain that makes things grow. So as a result, if we had to look at the image that I'm making here, humor as Medupe now comes as a subtle means. So it's very subtle. Also, it nurtures as well as it continues. And just at the beginning. And just at the beginning of the presentation, Professor Abobedo made us think that repetition has power. So that continuous, invocation of humor in political cartoons gradually awakens a people who already knew something. It just reinforces and then incites them to awake. So like humor in political cartoons, the conscience is softly and gently shape. So at this point, and for the sake of time, let me just go in and introduce Bright Ackwerh. Who be Bright Ackwerh? Well, Bright Ackwerh is an artist with a versatile practice, and as mentioned earlier, he holds a BFA and MFA, but I'm not going to go into that. He has like 5 years active practice, and also was the recipient of the Ghanaian Prize for Contemporary Art 2016. He's also a part of the top 10 artists in the 2017 Barclays Latelier Art Competition, and he's known now for his illustrative art pieces, especially upon some cartoons. So let me also evoke here a quote by James Baldwin, and this is something that Bright also does use in his political cartoons. James Baldwin says that the role of the artist is exactly the same as the role of the lover. If I love you, I have to make you conscious of the things you don't see. and we see a lot of this. Bright making us conscious of the blandness of the state in his cartoons. So then again, what is up with some cartoons? Well, Bright will go at length into it, but I just want to mention that it's an oeuvre of satirical works, making the using distortion, exaggeration, and territorialization, such a huge word, but advanced by Eko Lyonbe when he writes about political cartoons in Africa, that deterritorialization is simply taking people out of their familiar context and then bringing them into places that they are not, that they would normally not fit in. And for example, we see here Kufuado taken out of the Flagstaff House and now training for a boxing match, as if to revoking the notions of the corruption fights that he aimed at in the beginning. Also, up in some cartoons, they have comedic abilities and they borrow from popular culture. And from Bright's recent past exhibition, Almost True, in the catalog, they highlight that it becomes a route to highlight sensitive social, political, religious, and economic concerns, which once again goes to give strength to the Medupe concept. The form is also hugely digital, as Bright likes to penetrate these spaces, and maybe you tell us why you prefer that in whilst we have the engagement. He also uses a lot of aesthetic metaphors that is easily recognizable, and the visual details are really lush if you take a look at, as in the facial gestures and all of that. Bright does tend to spend a lot of time getting all of those details, which shows the inner characters of the people he intends to ridicule or praise. And also, they penetrate ubiquitous spaces, often on handhelds, as in our phones and computers, and also street corners, as you see in the picture here, whereby he has some of his posters inside of Atomic, the runabout. And they are imbued with double or triple and time drawers, as in the orderly catalog, they rightly noted. So sometimes you need a bit of help engaging with his work, else you'll find that it's completely new, or you know, you don't know what is happening. But at the same time, if you don't get it, it also becomes a fine piece of artwork. And Bright, among some cartoons, also tends to give it or aesthetically flesh thoughts and then movement. So for example, as in the next slide, we'll see with the Gandhi Mass Fall movement, Bright cartoon was definitely one that also helped to aesthetically flesh the movement, which gained quite about 2,000 signatures online. So why Silent Fat? Silent Fat basically was taken from an Ethiopian proverb, and this is my last slide before I engage Bright. And basically the proverb is that when the great Lord passes, the peasants bow deeply and silently fat. And that is how Bright uses humor to basically, as a silent fat that quietly permeates the consciousness, the people he wants to engage with his artworks. So thank you very much. And this is the first part of the presentation. The next would be now engaging Bright Ackwerh. Thank you. So, right, where do I start? But basically, I want us to begin from the notion of Abonsam cartoons. Abonsam cartoons in Ghana evoke pornography. So how does your work now relate to Abonsam cartoons or pornography?
Abonsam cartoons is literally street slang for pornography. And if you come from the place I come from, pornography was how we learned about sex and reproductive health issues. Those were the topics our parents were either too shy to open up to us about or too scared to talk about. But we all know without like good knowledge in that field, none of us would be here. You know? So later when I started making these kind of works, I began to think of a way to brand it. I wanted it to have that local connection to the people around me, because if I wanted to speak to anyone, they were the first people. So I thought about some cartoons, that source of vital knowledge that mainstream sources would not give you. It was the same way that I saw sex and reproductive health education. So my work somehow became the source of knowledge of the political, of the religious, of the social, the economic, that the mainstream channels were not giving to you. Also because growing up, I learned about a certain character we've come to call Abonsam, who questioned authority in the heavens, and because of that questioning, he was cast out and cast out to some burning place, eternal burning place. I wanted to see the beauty in that, you know, the sense of holding power accountable, and possibly even getting such harsh feedback for it, because we need, like, there are so many things we need to know about, and over here we don't, you know. But it doesn't mean you have to just relax and watch things go on. We need the knowledge, so we need to either create it, we need to go to the sources of knowledge and ask, and basically that is what my work seeks to do. That is why I call it Abonsam cartoons. Why is it a catchy name?
It is really catchy, and it's something that you definitely cannot miss. But so, with, I mean, you've mentioned that you wanted it to be like a source of political awareness. And with that source of political awareness, what are your intentions? What do you feel like people could do with that source of political awareness?
What people could do with the source? I think in our current dispensation that we are calling democracy, not only is it the people's right, but it's also their responsibility. In 2017, when we inaugurated our current president, he made a very popular speech, and I think the most catchy part was that Ghanaians needed to be citizens and not spectators anymore. Doing stuff like this, for me, is me exercising my right and then doing my responsibility, not even as an artist, just as a citizen. I believe it's work that I must do if I want to see my vision of this space, of Ghana, of Africa, of the world, change. I need to contribute my opinion every day, not just once in every 4 years, going queue and stamp, but every day I must contribute to it. There was one statement by Kofi Wayo that said, if in democracy, if you don't critique your condition, you become a traitor. And I don't want to be a traitor. I mean, nobody else wants to be a traitor too. So this is just me doing it with the gift that I have. This kind of work is done all the time in music, in film, in writing, so many ways. So I think this is me doing my part, and it goes to add to the way people are doing all other things too.
And before we get into your journey of like political, or where you are in political cartoons, I know that you started off doing mostly like realistic paintings, then also for your pieces you explored with cutout paintings and drawings. So how what's the journey to cartooning or to caricaturing? What has it been like for you, and when did it actually start?
I'm happy that you really looked into my work. So so when I left the KMUSD in 2015, I was experimenting with a lot of other things. And if there was one thing art students in the KMUSD were encouraged to do, it was experiment. So I was experimenting with a lot of things, and like you mentioned, painting realistically, playing with cutouts, so many forms that I still do or still go back to sometimes. But I got really, really inspired when I applied to study for my MFA. Between the time I applied and the time the school wrote me back to offer me admission, school fees have shot up from about 700 students to over 6,000. And that was because someone in some government office just got up and decided to scrap off government subsidies on postgraduate things. And I felt really, really touched. Prior to that, I'd always known that everybody played in the politics. You're either aware of it or not. And at that very moment, I think it was the last straw on the camel's back that broke the camel's back. I felt like I needed to say something. I wasn't looking at speaking for anyone. It was just for myself. And I largely still do speak for just myself. But I felt like I needed a way to release that tension, because now my parents wouldn't let me quit the idea of going back to school, and we had to pull some invisible strings to be able to shoot those bills, which I don't even know how we did it, but I felt like I needed to do something, you know, and my work was what I had, so I decided to use my work to speak, not just to that fees issue, but to everything else that was happening. If you live in Ghana, you know on the radio everything is politics. So everyone is socialized into that idea. It's politics every day, or football when we play with but we don't, we haven't played in Ghana in a long time. It's always politics now. So I felt like I needed to do something, and it was the one thing around me that was very, very important that I felt like I knew about. And so it was very easy for it to sort of flow into my work, and my work flow into it. And so it started, that was around 2013, and I'm sitting here with you today, so it's been a quite interesting journey so far.
Just as, so your work now became like you releasing that offensive gas that has been trapped inside of you. Also a way that you dealt with your own contemporary life challenges, if I'm to say. But then, using political cartoons, why did you settle particularly for political cartoons? Because you could have used any form of, or you are in an experimentation phase, so you could have used any form. So why political cartoons also imbued with like senses of you?
At the time, what was available to me was my laptop and social media or the internet. And I'm always of the idea that you don't need so much to create art. You can use what is around you that you know and just rebrand it or represent it, and it will be art. And so what did I have? My laptop, my graphics tablet. Political cartooning was a field that I think artists had explored extensively. There were a lot of political cartoons around me at the time, so it was also easy for me to experiment with it. Prior to that, I had been making nice cartoons of people on social media to get some shout outs and some, you know, some likes. And I thought, hey, I can actually do something more with this. I mean, that is fine, but I can do something more, I can try something else. And I had also just discovered the music of Afrikan boys, who are very, very strong in the social community space. And I was just inspired, you know, I began to see the possibilities of what could happen. And through my experimentation and sharing my work online and people's responses, I began to get more convinced to invest my time into trying these things. I would also bring in all the things I learned in my traditional painting classes, my oil painting classes, and all those things, all those ideas I tried to still put into my work, so that it looks, it's a political cartoon, but it doesn't look like the work of the next political cartoonist, because I need to have my work in me and not like everyone else. So it was like a combination of a lot of different influences.
Interesting. And so it turns like from late a visual piece, like, you know, wake up and then, you know, there is a bright cartoon in there, people, oh wow, you know. And what is for me special about bright cartoon is that it moves you from that so what is the journey like formulating a visual piece, like coming with
First of all, for me, first of all, I always have to tap into these conversational spaces, especially social media. You mentioned earlier social media, it's been very, very important to me and how I've been able to create so far. So I'm always, almost always online, reading what people, I read tweets very, very religiously. You know, I think tweets represent a certain aspect of people's thoughts. The way you are able to squeeze your whole opinion into just a limited number of texts and put it out. And because of your opinions, you're able to connect with like-minded people, you know, who think like you or don't think like you or whatever. But I'm always connected to these spaces, reading people's opinions, trying to know what people are passionate about at every point in time. I'm also invested in like popular culture around here. What is the biggest song on the radio? What is the biggest film in the cinemas? What are people talking about? What is going on in politics? I'm always trying to read the news and be abreast of what's going on, so that at any point in time when I decide to make a statement, I know which stories to draw metaphors from, so that I can speak with the people who are already listening to those things or who are already paying attention to those things. So if you look at my work, there's a lot of references to popular music, popular film, current events and the like. That aside, in the studio, I have my equipment, my laptop, my Wacom graphics tablet, and just my phone. And I create with these things. I'm always online, also looking for good reference images, because that's one thing the internet provides, a lot of information. So I'm looking for good reference images that I can draw from, especially of some of the characters who are recurring in my work. I usually have my brother, who is in the audience. That's what, he's a very, very faithful studio assistant, and we do whole photo shoots on my phone, you know, because I'm very particular about the gestures in my work and how I'm able to communicate using facial expressions and just poses, sometimes referencing from already existing work and the like. So we do these photo shoots on my phone, which then becomes extra reference to draw opinions from. Because if you've seen that, you know I'm very particular about certain kinds of details. And also because I don't use text, I don't like limiting my context or my narrative. So I sort of leave them open to interpretation, and then it helps also creating double meanings and triple meanings, always, sometimes to get out of trouble. You know, so that is how it happens, and aside that, I'm always trying to create something.
Due to time, we skipped some of the questions, but so I wanted to find out also, like, in terms of responses to your work, what has been some of the most provocative responses,
how we navigated
those responses.
Okay, so one of the things I decided along the way was that if I feel I have the right to say what I want to say, then people also have the right to feel the way they want to feel about my work. One of my most interesting responses has been the China one, obviously. They actually help expose my work to a lot more people. That was about 2 years ago when Galaxy was the big thing, and I made a series of paintings telling the story of Galaxy from my point of view, and they saw my work and I think they actually liked it because they came to an exhibition we had at the Science and Technology Museum. Black Star Lines held an exhibition in 2017 and the Chinese embassy was invited. The ambassador, the then ambassador and their own entourage came to the show, and they were very happy, they were taking pictures with my painting and all that. But there's that prior to that, they issued some letter to the government with some kind of threats, and they sent memos to the media houses. And I have some friends in the media who sent me like a copy of the memo, you know, and they were very happy about how we're depicting them and all that. But I think it goes to also speak about the culture of artistic freedom and press freedom here. You know, coming from China, where those things largely don't exist, and coming here and seeing that these things are here and artists are thriving because of it, you know, I think there was a certain culture shock for them, but I think we also taught them a little about Ghanaian culture and how these things are supposed to be around.
But then don't you feel like when, for instance, having a Chinese ambassador who you caricature stand next to the work, don't you feel like it somehow waters down the message that you're trying to put across?
Yeah, it's very interesting. It's like we're all playing shadow tactics. And my thing was, oh, once they liked it, it meant I should paint more of it. You know, because they liked it, so I'm like currently producing a lot more paintings, you know, in that direction. And if they still like it, you see. It's all good.
At this point, we would want to invite in the audience whilst we still like engage with Bright Ackwerh, so questions like that.
Okay, I think we should first of all give them a round of applause. Thank you. I mean, I can see up front that we need to have sessions like this, right?
Yep.
Very important. Okay, so without wasting time and reserving my comments toward the end, we'll take questions. So we'll begin with that. Come on right here.
Bright Ackwerh, it's very good to meet you in person. I became aware of your work during Gandhi Must Fall, and then I found out a whole lot more. I did more searching. And the Gandhi Must Fall cartoon that you did was very controversial here at the university. So you were talking about how it lets you know the amount of freedom in the society also here at the university. So that picture was posted here on this wall by Selaje during his exhibition, and he was told by someone at the head office, who I don't know, to remove it, and he actually did remove it. You know, initially he was talking about he would take down his paintings and leave, but he made a different decision and he ended up removing it. Also, I also sent it out to the listserv in an email, and after that at the university they started monitoring the UG staff email and moderating that one and the student email, and anytime I send an email, they reject it, but they allow, and it was not only me, Professor Ademarco Ampofo, I thought it was just me until I sent an email to Public Affairs Directorate, the VC, Pro-VC, the Director of Institute of African Studies, and then Professor Ademarco Ampofo, who was also trying to be VC, not too long ago, she said, oh, I've also had the exact same thing, so I have to send it to Alma Dodson, and then she sends it out, you know, anything for the list. So I think what I'd like to say is congratulations, keep up the work. Some of us here all are struggling with censorship right here in the university community, but I think we get inspiration mutually and mutually illuminate each other. So if I'm doing work here at the university, you're doing work in other spaces, including now the university as well. I think that we should join forces and find ways that we can do other things together. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much.
My name is Ali, and I love this stuff, that's for sure. But my question has to do with what is popular and what is not, because you know, these things you talk about, like the moments that broke the camera's back, I think for many of us, we've been through these moments. And one thing I personally have come to realize in the Ghanaian media landscape or the activism and so on and so forth, it's like for instance, the Gandhi Must Fall issue and many different issues. I feel like in this society, you know, popular issues, but then it's also that, what about the other, you know, sanitation, you know, like policing, the traffic systems, poor roads, you know, my thinking is always like the basic things, the basic things are not solved, so are artists like yourself addressing that, or do you find issues like that of importance, whereas that it's not popular, so it will never end up, you know, on your drawing table?
I'm interested in a lot of things. When you live in a space like this, and for an artist like myself, I basically struggle to pick topics because there is so much, almost too much. You know, I feel like people literally go out and do these things so that they end up in work like this. You know, so, and because of the nature of our media landscape, and because I'm always trying to keep my conversation going, I choose my topics in a certain way. But yes, I am concerned about all those things you spoke about and more. And eventually, all those things will get addressed. Also, it's not just me. There are like a lot of other artists out there. So sometimes when I'm not tackling a particular issue, I believe other artists are doing it because it's not a job I'm doing by myself. I think as a community, and even yourself, because you're an artist, I do your work. So I think all of us, you know, someone does this today, someone does the other one today. And together, you know, we'll have our vision realized. But thank you for the prompt.
Can we know a little more about you?
So my name is Eli Afri, and I am a singer, songwriter, composer, and on some days, a podcaster. Music, that's what I do.
Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Nangamso. I'd just like to thank both of you, Bright and Yao, in our chair for a wonderful, really engaging presentation. I have a lot of questions, but I'll bring them down to two. First of all, I'd just like to commend you on the way in which you've located the intimacy between sensitivity and desensitivity in your work. And I want to find out from you or ask you how you, when you're creating, how do you draw the line between, because in many ways, humor can sometimes desensitize a lot of issues that we experience as people, especially when you're looking at things like politics. So we see memes on social media, which are funny, but sometimes they desensitize. So how do you draw the line or locate that spot where you don't necessarily desensitize the issue and you get the message across as powerful as it needs to be, but also with that light approach? And then my second question is, how do you feel your role or your responsibility as an artist is in terms of creating your work? I think it was Ta Nehisi Coates who said something about how artists are meant to be a mirror to society, and in some cases we believe that they might have to do more than just being a mirror, but being an agent. So do you think that your role is just to be a mirror and say, okay, society, this is what's happening, look at this and decide what you want to do with it? Or is it, so this is what's happening, what are we going to do about it, let's do something about it? Thank you.
Thank you for the questions. Second one first. As an artist, I believe primarily your role is to create your art and share your art. What society chooses to do with it later, it's up to society to decide. Primarily, holding a mirror up to society and exaggerating what they are doing, sometimes it's like a what-if analysis. Like, if you continue doing this, this is where you're going to end up. Or this is what you really look like. Have you considered this part? And then whatever happens next, it's up to them. Whether you're desensitizing or rather sensitizing the public. it require me to think more about it before I can say something. So if you wouldn't mind, we'll have that conversation after here. But it's very, very important, you know, and we'll talk about it.
My name is Cognate Ariabua. In 20 years' time, 50 years' time, if people look up to your work, I'm asking this question basically because the remark that you made about text, and also about the responses that you get on social media, for example. Would people see your work and then lose the narrative in 20 years' time? When, for example, you're not taking into consideration people's responses or things that prompted the work. I'm asking this basically because also social media has become a sort of an archive. So, for example, when Obama finished his tenure, the archive institution in the U.S. Archived it so that it would be a source of material. So, you are eliciting responses and all those things, which I think are thermals of your work. We live in institutions in a country that normally do not have archives in contemporary stuff. What do you think, if you are to take up other roles, how would it benefit your work 30, 15 years from now?
If you are to take other roles,
for example, as an archivist, archiving the responses that you are getting on social media, for example.
Yes, the conversations that my work inspire are very, very important for me personally. And one thing that I do also very religiously is to document some of these responses I get online. So I have a whole folder of screenshots, which I'm collecting now. I have plans later to publish some of my work with writing. As to text in the work itself, I don't know if you were speaking about that in the beginning, but text in the work itself, I don't use because I feel it tends to limit the narrative. So that if I had a piece and I had a caption in it, then if you saw the work, then automatically the caption was to explain what the picture meant, and that was it. Because I'm the author of the work, that is the meaning, that is it. But if the work is without text, what's going on? There's been times when people have explain my work to me in ways I didn't even consider and I thought it made more sense. So that exchange for me is important. But yes, I'm very aware of our culture of not documenting or archiving well enough. And for my part, I think I'm doing it. I'm working with other writers as well whose job is to write. So with their skill, we are going to document something about my work. Hopefully it will inspire a change in how we document other things as well.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, so in the absence of other questions,
okay, so I'm interested in what the government's response was to the Chinese embassy's letter to them.
What the government's response was? Well, I don't know how they do their stuff there, but after that issue, I had some conversations about some other responses. Maybe I'm not. I don't know who's in the room right now. So. I'm not going to talk about it. I mean, I can tell you later, but there were some very interesting responses. Maybe it should have scared me, but actually it motivated me because now I know the people I'm trying to speak with are listening. I'd rather have them listen and get mad or whatever than to be overlooked and not paid attention to. But after that, I received a very special invitation to dinner with the president himself. And I was on a radio show with the then Minister of Information, and we had our exchanges. And yeah, so I think they listened or they heard it.
From the official, officially wrote to you?
Ghana is supposed to be the best country on the continent for press freedom. That is why we had World Press Freedom Day 2018 here in May. And that was the dinner, special dinner I was invited to. Only that the next week, somebody slapped the journalist because they said she looked like an onion seller. I don't know how that confirms or debunks that notion of Ghana being a state with press freedom, but I think we'll see how that pans out later. So.
Just looking at the stuff you exhibited at the atomic.
Atomic.
Yeah, at the atomic junction.
Yeah.
For me, I wonder what have you given it thought to do more of this outside of the galleries, outside of social media, because for the kind of thing you do, and if you look at the image here. That man over there, like many Ghanaians, will never ever see your work, if not in the open, or if it isn't put in spaces outside of what we presume to be the spaces Ghanaian consume information and whatnot from. So if you've given that, the question is if you've given that any consideration and to make more of such.
That was an experiment as part of an exhibition. Black Star Lines had an exhibition, and part of my piece, which was in the exhibition, was to do my work offsite. It was an experiment. It's something I'm very, very interested in, but I have to pull the right kind of resources to make it possible. I said earlier, I'm working with what is available to me right now, making the most out of it. At the time, I was able to galvanize some funds to do that. And like I said, it's something I'm very, very interested in. Only that that space is very, very interesting. It's a very, very powerful space, street poster making and display. And the AMA seeks to clamp down on it. However, if you went through the road by the Parliament House, you see Mohammed's posters there, you see Nanado's posters there, you know, so if those making the laws for me to not do it are doing it themselves, then how do we negotiate that space? So it's a very, very powerful tool. I'm looking at doing more of these street poster designs and displays. Yes.
So also when I thought of this presentation too, the idea was also to bring into the academic like community creative ways of disseminating information. For example, if you have to see to our right, our mission also entails disseminating like information, and how you do it as a creative medium or creative source, and also in a funny comical way reaches more people. So my first question is, would you consider later working in hand with people from the academic community? Let's say a whole thesis is now condensed into a single image, and do you feel like that is a possibility, something you could take on? And my second question actually skipped me, but I'll leave you to the first.
Yes, I was very happy when you decided to do this with me. I'm always open to collaborating with whoever, wherever, especially people in academia. I've presented my work to quite a number of institutions and student groups. And it's important because not only am I given, but the feedback that I get is very, very crucial for me and how I think about future work. So yes, if the institution wants to engage me on any level at all, I'm open to it. But it's also about if the institution is ready or open enough, because I know institutions have a lot of very rigid structures. If they are ready to be open for someone like myself or an artist like myself with the kind of ideas I'm working with to do the work that you're asking about, if they are ready. So.
Okay. Okay, so in closing, I just have a few remarks, and I begin by, number one, encouraging all the graduate students to think seriously about presenting their work in front of us, right? It's very important, and we just had a good example. Of course, I qualified as good. I don't know about you, but I still stand by my words. So it's a good model for us. And more so, we have the mentors, the advisors, supervisors, some of them around, right? So they too draw some inspiration from you participating in this intellectual forum. Very important. And again, in terms of some closing remarks, there are many issues, and at the same time, I see common grounds and common canvases, except that Yao is not a practicing artist. Can he draw? So again, we have common ground, but not common canvases. There are issues about sensibilities and sensitivities, and they can be both dialectical and dialogic. And we cannot separate both. And these also invoke instantly notions of boundaries, meaning artistic license. How much can you say without being handcuffed? We are dealing with the same issue in interdisciplinary circles. For example, one of our most recent books in music is called Censorship in Popular Music in Africa. And more so, talking about boundaries, interdisciplinarity. Of course, we heard about James Baldwin, Kofi Wayo, our own president, talking about engaging the audience, right? We heard about our president saying that citizens should not be just spectators, right? And Kofi Wayo says what he says, if you don't protect, and you are a traitor. So participatory, very important, critical intervention. Whether you want it or not, we are informing, taking feedback from our audience, right? So we can never ignore the larger audience. In fact, you mentioned the word like, if they like, so and so. Talking about audience, right? What are they like, what they don't like? You draw inspiration. And in defining the audience, don't forget about virtual communities, digital space. You heard about responses from tweets, web spaces, on and on. Very important. It's part of us now. And again, going on and quickly, talking about the artist reinventing himself or herself, representing, not just presenting. That's very important. I mean, Cecilia is talking about the presentation of the self in everyday life. Well, it's not just a simple way of presenting, it's representing, shifting identities. Identities always in a flux. Similarly, perspectives, tools, and ideas of artists are always in flux. Whether it's politics going on, how they inform the artist's ideas and tools, these are very important. And Yao was engaging some other ideas such as deterritorialization. What did you say about that, Yao?
So it is that.
So the movement of like authorities from their familiar places of comfort into territories that they are not at all familiar with. So
that question is very important today when we talk about deterritorialization. Of course, we instantly invoke the larger issue of re-deterritorialization also, which also subsumes what? Mobilities. From one space to another, right? Never feeling comfortable in one place. Mobility is very important in these days. Whatever we write, whatever we feel, whatever we eat. I mean, the idea of to go. Mobilities, right? It's an everyday practice. And at the beginning of Yao's talk, he broke down the dimensions of contemporary. He says around the 1980s, time frame, right? You start with the 1980s, and you mention some key personalities. I don't know if Dr. Mollifying is here, but you know there are other dimensions of defining the contemporary. So we hope that in your own work and your colleagues in the future, we can learn more about Ghanaian society in terms of focusing on the sensitivities, sensibilities of today, the contemporary. And on that note, I want us to again give a special applause to our guest first. And then, yeah. And then to ourselves. Thank you again.
It's an idea.